All right, stay standing while I read the word of the Lord. I'll explain this and get into it. It's going to probably be a very familiar scripture for this house and for a lot of houses of intercession. Isaiah 22:22. Come on, somebody. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder. I said there's authority on this hill. So he shall open. Everybody shout open. And no one shall shut. Hallelujah. And he shall shut and no one shall open. Hallelujah. I believe with all of my heart. I'll let you be seated in 20 seconds. If any of you have ever watched me preach and heard me say that, you know it means absolutely nothing. Amen. When I say that. Hallelujah. I believe with all of my heart. This is what the Lord spoke to me some months ago. He said, Kim, can you believe for a nation-shaking, history-making revival so that the next generation will have a reference point? Even after going on 7 years of sustained revival in Peoria, Arizona, the West Valley of the Phoenix area, the Lord said, can you believe, Kim, for a nation-shaking, history-making revival so that the next generation, when they look back on this generation, whether you are 80 or 18 years old in this room, we're all in this generation. And the Bible tells us that David served his generation well. Come on. When you serve a generation well, you may have to face a lion and a bear and a Goliath and an angry king, come on, and two sons that will sell you out. Somebody help me in the room right now. But if you serve your generation well, you know how to slay giants. Come on. You know how to overcome betrayal. I am preaching even before I'm preaching. Come on. You know how to kill things that look bigger and stronger than you are in the spirit, even though they're not, because we know Jesus is stronger than anything that the enemy has. Help me, somebody. But if you serve your generation well, you understand that it is a fight. And any time that we are birthing a revival that is a nation-shaking, history-making, you are living in an area that had a nation-shaking, history-making revival. You are living in an area where tears were shed and knees were worn. Come on, somebody. And voices went hoarse. Come on, somebody. At the preaching of the word and the crying out in travail and in intercession. My God, I feel the Holy Ghost right now. You are living in an area where it once happened. And God says that is good and that is awesome. But will you pay the price to birth a nation-shaking, history-making revival so that your grandchildren, so that my grandchildren, so that their children and their children can have a criterion and an example to look back on and say, look what Mimi did. I'm Mimi. Come on, somebody. Don't you dare call me grandma. Come on, somebody. Look what Mimi did. Look what Mimi did. Look what Grandpa did. Look what this one did. Look what that one did. Look, look. This is how they prayed. This is how they worshiped. Come on, somebody. This is how they praised. And look what God did. The heavens broke open. And I have a whole message on this, and that's not necessarily what I'm preaching tonight. But here's what the thing is that it is good to talk about the Hebrides revival. It is awesome to talk about Azusa Street. It is amazing to talk about the Welsh revival, the Great Awakenings. It's awesome. We need those things. Why do we need those things? The Brownsville revival. Are you with me? The Lakeland revival. We need those things. The Fresh Start revival. Come on, somebody. We need those things so we can look back and have a determining point, a reference point. But God says, will you do the hard work that 15 intercessors did on Bonnie Bray Street to birth a nation-shaking, history-making revival called Azusa Street? Will you do the hard work that Evan Roberts did and two 80-year-old women did? Come on, somebody. That birthed the Hebrides and the Welsh revival. I say up in this room on this hill of authority that I got some people that came on a Monday night that says, I am willing, God, to do whatever it takes to birth a revival that anyone and everyone can look back and say, this is what God can do and more. Come on. But it's going to take a remnant, amen? A remnant. Pray in the Holy Ghost for 30 seconds. Come on, and I'm going to get into the word. Come on, did you feel that tonight? Did you feel that tonight? Did you feel that? Come on, 15 seconds. Get ready to shout. Get ready to shout. Get ready to shout. Lord, we release a shout over the word that has been released, oh God. I thank you that you are building a new tenacity and a new stamina and, yes, a new capacity in the people tonight to birth the revival that this nation is going to hear, write, sing, and talk about, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, it can't just happen in Arizona. It's got to happen in every region in this nation. So lift a shout of unity in this room one more time. Come on, right now, lift a shout of unity in this room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. On your way down to your seat, hallelujah, high five, hit somebody, whatever you want to do, and say, I'm going to do my part. Come on, I'm going to do my part. I'm going to do my part to birth this revival across the nation. Amen. Hallelujah. I believe with all of my heart, as we have entered into 2022, are we thankful for this year? Come on. No, you're not thankful? Are you thankful? Oh, you're still high-fiving your neighbor. Sorry about that. Come on. I believe that we have not only just turned the calendar page, if you will, into just another year, but I believe that we have come into another era of the Lord. Are you with me? And God is looking for a tenacious, rambunctious, intense, fiery, zealous, crazy, radical remnant. Come on, somebody. Do I have anybody like that in the room tonight? Amen. The Lord gave this to me to speak to our people. It was just in an exhortation time, not necessarily a message, but I've been sharing it at a few places, and I want to say it as I segue into the message that I've got for you tonight, reading from the scripture Isaiah 22:22. But I believe with all of my heart that God is gathering his remnant in this nation. We'll just talk about our nation. It's all the nations of the earth, but in this nation for such a time as this. And I felt the Lord say some things like this. In that flow of the service, God is looking, God is longing, and God is searching for a remnant of revivalists who will raise the standard in these last days. God says, tell the people they need to make the cut for the remnant. God says, tell the people to get ready. Tell the remnant to get ready. Tell the people to prepare themselves. A remnant, he says, is a smaller piece of a larger thing. And he says, so many people are trying to be a part of the larger thing. Come on. So I'm going to say this because the next time that we start shouting and touting about the remnant, we need to stop and think what we're saying. Come on. Because the remnant is a smaller piece of a larger thing. Shout amen if you're with me. Come on. And the Lord says there's so many people that are trying to be a part of the larger thing. Man, I'm just going to nail some stuff tonight. Are you ready? Are you ready? I'm just going to nail some stuff. So many people trying to be a part of the larger thing. But when you tear a remnant or you tear a piece from a larger piece, there is a tearing away. And the Lord said in these last days, there will be those who have enough oil and there will be those who run out of oil. And I saw in the spirit that God was, while the larger piece was trying to settle back, if you will, into their spot in the larger piece of the material, if you will, as we would say, God is taking his holy hands in the heavens and he is ripping and he is cutting and he is tearing the remnant away. You're not hearing me. He is ripping, he is cutting. cutting and he is tearing the remnant away. And the Lord said in that moment, he said, remnant, be ready to raise the standard. And he said, while when the ripping and the tearing comes, those in the larger piece will see how far away that they can get from the ripping and the tearing and the cutting, because the ripping and the cutting and the tearing is uncomfortable, and the ripping and the cutting and the tearing takes the spotlight off of them and puts the spotlight on him. The ripping and the cutting and the tearing means that I have to lose some things that I've held tightly to. I have to decrease so that he can increase. The Lord said those who are trying to settle back into their pre-2020 place, in their nice spot, in the larger piece or the larger part, will be the ones who run out of oil. The Lord says, tell the people, make the cut. Make the cut. Make the cut. Make the cut. It might mean, the Lord says, that we have to be cut. Come on, somebody. But any time that there is a covenant, there has to be a cutting. And God is looking for covenant people who are willing to be cut, people who don't care who gets the credit, people who do not negotiate the hard times and the rough places. He says this remnant will have a tenacious pursuit. They will have a hunger, they will have a sound, they will have a spiritual intensity, they will have heavy devotionals with the Lord and a holy living. And the Lord says to the remnant, make the cut. Make the cut. Don't be afraid to be singled out. Don't be afraid and don't be tempted to settle back in when the cutting begins. God says, I'm cutting and I'm tearing. Who will be on the side of the remnant? Come on, somebody. Yes. Make the cut. Screaming at your neighbor, saying, make the cut, make the cut, make the cut. Hallelujah. Because I fully believe that there will be those who feel that they are making the cut, if you will. But they're going to be surprised, because it's going to take those who are tenacious and know how to persevere in these times that we live in. Are you hearing the word of the Lord? It's going to take those who are tenacious, who have some spiritual intensity, who don't care what people say about them. Come on. They don't have to be on top. They don't have to have a microphone. They don't have to be on the flyer. Come on, somebody. They don't have to have their name and lights. Help me, somebody. Come on. Come on. All they want to do is they want to be obedient to the Lord. They want to make the cut for the remnant. They want to establish the kingdom of God, and they want to usher in revival. Amen? And so the Lord gave me a word as we come into 2020, and it's called the prepared ones, the prepared ones. Ask a couple of people around you, are you prepared tonight? Are you prepared? Because the remnant will make sure that they have enough oil. The remnant will make sure that they are prepared. I need you to ask your neighbor a little bit louder. Now, in case you're wondering, and I know this is probably a little different circling camp, but I'm a third generation Pentecostal preacher. I know we got a different camp and circle going on here, but you're looking at a third generation Pentecostal preacher. So I scream a lot. So if you're sitting back and wondering, when is she going to stop screaming? Probably not all night. Come on, somebody. I am Pentecost to the core. I don't apologize for it. As a matter of fact, I think that's what Jesus, the church, Jesus is coming back for. I'm not saying that with a name on it or a denomination. I say the Pentecostal people in function as they were in the book of Acts. Come on. They were radical. The first picture that we see of the church was drunk men and women with fire on their heads. Come on, somebody. We got to stop our laziness. We got to stop our apathy. We got to stop our negotiating. Give me a high five. We got to stop. We got to stop our negotiating with, oh my, is this proper or not? Come on. Those people busted out of the upper room and they were full of the fire of God. The fire of God is recognizable. You can't hide the fire. We're going to do it again. You can't hide the fire. If you're, don't tell me you're on fire and you're not burning. Don't tell me you're on fire and I can't see it evident in your life. If you're on fire, honey, you can't hide it, and it changes everything in your life and in your landscape of your family. And I am convinced that we need Pentecostal preaching in these last days, because Pentecostal preaching shreds the atmosphere of religion, and religion has taken over this nation. And in the name of Jesus, as long as I have breath in my lungs and somebody will hand me a microphone, and even if they don't, I will preach and shred atmospheres so that revival can manifest in territories. You say that's irreverent. I say you go on with your sentimental self and just see what you get accomplished. I'm telling you, demons recognize valid authority, and we don't always have to scream. I get that, but it's a lot funner. Come on, somebody. And it's actually waking some of you up right now. Preaching shreds atmospheres. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There is an authority on this hill, the Lord said. The key of the house of David I will lay on his shoulder. So he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open. The Lord gave me this as we rounded the corner into 2022. I'm going to move quickly tonight. And then we're going to pray. Amen. Come on, somebody. We're going to pray. 22, and I know y'all know this well, but to give credit where credit needs to go. The number 22, which, by the way, is amazing because I've looked at the clock several times, and whatever all those numbers are up there, many times it has says 22. Come on, somebody. Has come to be identified as governmental authority birthed through prayer. Yes. Governmental authority birthed through prayer. I said there's authority on this hill. Come on. In my life, and probably yours as well, it was Dutch Sheets, Apostle Dutch Sheets, who I believe it was the book Authority and Prayer, who gave a story and the confirmations that the Lord had given him in his life concerning Isaiah 22:22. You can look it up and read it for yourself, but that's how I came across, of course, the revelation of this verse and governmental authority, the key of prayer to open and to close spiritual doors. Help me, y'all. If you want revival, and I know you know this, you got to open and you got to close some spiritual doors. Come on. Stay with me. But I cannot help but feel that this revelation, even that the Lord gave Dutch and now has gone, you know, national, international, possibly in the hearts of God's people, the revelation of governmental authority and the key of prayer to open and close spiritual doors, I can't help but feel that this revelation is for such a time as this. Revelation is for such a time as this. As we have entered into 2022, the revelation on Isaiah 22:22 is for such a time as this. I know he's been speaking it and many others for many years, but here's the thing. There are strategic moments when God will pull a card, if you will, or a play, as we say, that he has hidden or reserved for a this time. Come on. I said for a this time. For a such a time as this. Say it with me. Such a time as, somebody say it's a this time. Come on. 2022 is a this time. Come on. I'm not saying it's going to be easy. As a matter of fact, I don't think this year is going to be easy. Other prophets may think different, but I don't think it's going to be easy. And the reason why I say that is because of the amount of warfare that I've already faced in just whatever day we're on, 17 days into 2022. But I'm not scared and I'm not afraid, because there's authority on the hill. Come on. And authority comes to those who are prepared. And so I believe that it is a this time. Hear me now. If we're waiting for everything to be perfect, if we're waiting for everything to be just perfectly aligned and there to be a perfect scenario, it's not ever going to happen. Come on. So we've got to understand the depth of this revelation and say, in the midst of chaos, help me, y'all, in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of everything that is going awry in our nation and in our territories around us, the ecclesia is rising up with the authority that has been given to her, the remnant ecclesia, and she is exercising that authority for such a time as this. Amen? Everybody say, it's a this time. Come on. Now, the key is to recognize that it is a this time, to recognize that it is an event, if you will, an event that God has positioned, as such as on the day of Pentecost had fully come. The day of Pentecost had fully come. It is a this time. And with that said, we must, as the remnant ecclesia, which is why I took a moment to exhort you on the remnant ecclesia, because not everyone that touts they are the ecclesia are the ecclesia, because there's going to be a cutting and there's going to be a tearing. And the Lord says, make sure that you make the cut. Come on, somebody. Make the cut, because there will be a remnant ecclesia in this nation. And I know other nations, but let's talk about our nation tonight. How many know America's going to see a revival? Come on. How many know America's going to see an awakening? But it's going to take a prepared remnant ecclesia that operates in authority to unlock some spiritual doors and lock up some things that have been loose. Come on. And God says, when they get together, not just only physically, but in the spirit, you're going to begin to see a shifting over this nation. And I'm just going to say it like this. We're doing our part on the West Coast. Can I get somebody that'll do their part on the East Coast? Come on. High five your neighbor. Say, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Hallelujah. There must be a remnant ecclesia who understand the absolute necessity of walking in the true fullness of the number 22. Come on. Of spiritual governmental authority. Governmental authority that is birthed and released by prayer. This is the hope of the nation. Come on, somebody. I said, this is the hope of the nation, and we are to ask for the nations. So if we're going to ask for the nations, then we're going to have to understand great revelation. Now, I'm not pretending. I know that you all probably understand deep this revelation, but I'm taking you somewhere tonight. Are you with me? Shout yes if you're with me. Come on. Great authority. This is what the phrase the Lord spoke to me. Great authority comes to the prepared ones. Yes. So I ask us tonight, are you just walking into 2022, or are you walking in 22, meaning the authority of the Lord? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Isaiah 22:22 again, the key of the house of David. I will lay on his shoulder, so he shall open and no one shall shut, and he shall shut and no one shall open. Governmental authority birthed through prayer. Great authority comes to the prepared ones. Preparation is, of course, defined as to put in proper readiness, condition, or order. This kind of authority, I'm going to refer to it tonight as number 22, all right, from Isaiah 22:22 and the year 2022. This kind of spiritual authority, the price is high and is very costly. Matthew chapter 25, verse 3 and 4, and then verse 10, it says this: those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil. Nudge your neighbor. Say, you better have your own oil. Come on, somebody. And they took with them their own oil, but the wise took their oil in their vessels with their lamps. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready or prepared, shout prepared, went in with him to the wedding, and the door was shut. My God, just listen to that scripture. The door was shut. I said, God is taking his holy hands, and he is tearing, and he is cutting. Who is going to make the cut for the remnant? Come on. great authority comes to the prepared ones. Esther chapter 2, verse 12, and then verse 17. Each young woman's turn came to go into the king. And after she had completed 12 months preparation, according to the regulations for the women, for thus were the days of their preparation apportioned, 6 months with oil of myrrh and 6 months with perfumes and preparations for beautifying women, the king loved Esther, verse 17, more than all the other women, and she obtained grace and favor. Stay with me, church. She obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the other virgins. So he set the royal crown upon her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. Great authority comes to the prepared ones. Say that with me. Great authority comes to the prepared ones. Or we can say those who make the cut. Help me, y'all. Those who make the cut. I believe that 2022 is a this time, for such a time as this. Esther arose in a national crisis. You know the scriptures well. You know the book of Esther well. She arose in a national crisis. And I have preached this in different ways, but the Lord showed me and said, Kim, I'm emphasizing that they people must be prepared in this hour to deal with the onslaught of the enemy, but also to be able to release the authority that I need them to release in the nation. It was a national crisis that was Esther found herself in. And Mordecai told her, you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Come on, 22. You have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. My God, sometimes we are trained for a lifetime for a this time. I'm going to say it again. Sometimes we are trained for a lifetime for a this time. I'm going to say it again because y'all can shout louder than that. Sometimes we are trained for a lifetime for a this time. But what happens a lot of times is we get out of line and we get out of order because we don't think that it's working fast. That's why I say we break delay off of revival coming into this region. We get out of order. We get out of alignment. But what really is happening is God says, I'm preparing you. 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 I didn't come to tell our story about how we walked into sustained revival, because you hear me now, church. You don't just accidentally walk into revival. It is an intentional pursuit into the outpouring of God. But there was an ordering of our steps, pastors. There was an ordering of our steps. And when you follow the order of the Lord and the path of the Lord, as we say it, the breadcrumbs of the Holy Spirit, as you do that, then every, my God, every step that you take of obedience, it increases your capacity. We got the body of Christ, Pastor. Peter, right? About this much capacity. Oh, I got quiet in here. It's the truth. It's the truth. And many times it's the pulpit's fault because we have groomed them that we're only going to be here for a few minutes, y'all, so just hang in. Come on, help me, y'all. Help me. What happened to old-time church? Come on. Where you bring a snack and you bring a lunch. Come on. But no, not anymore. Not in this Disneyland mentality of church, where it's like you got to give me a fun ride, you got to give me some snacks, you got to give me a donut, you got to entertain me, you got to do a few cartwheels, you got to bring the flannel graph. Come on, help me preach down here. You know what I'm talking about. And what we have done is we have kept the spiritual capacity of people about like this. Come on. And they don't care about the ordered steps of the Lord. All they want is just to do their church thing and be over with. But God is looking. God is cutting. God is tearing a remnant in 2022 for such a time as, so that there can be an authority that is released from the ecclesia that shifts things in nations, come on, so that his manifest presence can touch down mountains, bow at your presence, oh God. Obstacles move out of the way at your presence. But with every step you take, there's a capacity increase. And prepared ones understand that. Esther didn't just run into the king. She prepared. Great authority, the Holy Spirit spoke to me, comes to the prepared ones. Sometimes you train for a lifetime, for this time. In these days that we are living in, there is a grace coming to the prepared ones. Come on. Can I say some stuff? Whether you say yes or not, I'm going to say it anyway. A grace to persevere. A grace to persevere. Nudge your neighbor, say, don't be a wimp. Come on. See, in Pentecostal church, we talk to each other a lot. Come on, y'all. Say, don't be a wimp. Don't be a wimp. I mean, be kind to them, but just say, don't be a wimp. Amen? Come on. There's going to come a great grace, the Lord is saying, in these days to persevere. So preparation must be made so that grace can be granted for such a time as this. The scripture said Esther obtained grace and favor. Esther obtained grace and favor. Hear this. I sense that 2022 can be a year of immense harvest and victory for revival. The emphasis is on the two words, can be. There will be great authority given to the prepared ones. As we understand the depth of the number 22, obviously, that I've already begun to explain to you, representing governmental authority and prayer to open and close spiritual doors, we cannot skip the preparation process. Now, as I begin to prepare this message, I said, Lord, the first thing, and I would probably be guilty of it as well, is that people are automatically going to start thinking, I'm already prepared. Come on now. So I said, the Holy Spirit said, even the more reason to preach it. I think maybe we thought we were prepared going into 2020. Come on, somebody. And look what 2020 did. Yeah, clap with Ron. Come on, somebody, clap with him. It's the truth. It's the truth. Did that make sense to you? Come on. As a lot of people thought they were prepared. A lot of Christians thought they were prepared going into 2020, quoting the scripture. Oh, whatever nation needs a fearless church. And I'm up in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm like, my God, where's the fearless church? Come on, somebody. Come on. Presumption is the only limitation of this authority that I'm preaching to us about. Assuming that it is there when it is not. Taking it for granted without paying the price to truly carry it. I said to truly carry it. And then what we do is we make up stuff when we don't actually carry it. Come on, somebody. Assumption is a dangerous place to be because complacency is shrouded in assumption. My God, I'm going to preach. I've got about 20 points tonight. I'm just kidding. Assumption is a dangerous place to be. And the Lord said this, and I feel this very strongly still. And he told me this, and this once again was in the flow of one of our services. He said, the grace is going to run out. The grace is going to run out. What you've fallen back on before in prior seasons and in prior years, that is not going to be there now, the Lord says. And I'm not talking about saving grace. I'm talking about the grace that has kept people. And I'm not talking about heathens. I'm talking about Christians. Come on. That they have been living any old way. Help me preach. Come on. They've been living. I'm still a holiness preacher. Come on, somebody. They've been living any old way. They've been up in all kinds of pride, got a know-it-all spirit, got a Jezebel thing going on. Help me preach, y'all. Come on. And they've been, and they've been, you know, lackadaisical about their commitment. And I may be in one week. I may not be. Pastor, if I don't have anything else to do. You see, I'm not just a revivalist. I've been a pastor for 38 years. Come on, somebody. So I know what I'm talking about. I might be there if the football game doesn't go too long. Help me, y'all. I might be there. Come on now. If I feel well, if this is all, if the, you know, if the planets align and the sun is this and it's no clouds in New Jersey, which I don't think that happens around here. Come on, somebody. It's like I might be there on the hill with authority. You ain't going to be nowhere with authority. Hear me now. Hear what I'm saying. The Lord says that the grace that you have fallen back on in seasons past is not going to be there any longer. God says he's not doing it because he doesn't love people. He's doing it because he is wrapping this thing up, and he has to reveal his remnant. He has to reveal his remnant. So there's going to be a cutting and a tearing, and part of it is that one day, that grace that you fell back on, honey, you're going to go all the way back. Come on. And you won't bounce up like you did the last time. You said, that's pretty negative. It may be negative, my friend, but you hear me? God is serious. He's serious about the times that we live in, and we must be serious as well. Somebody shout yes. Come on. Woo. So the Lord says, this can be a year of immense harvest and victory for revival. If we're going to have immense victory, it demands immense authority, right? Listen closely, and I'm going to go fast. Esther went through intentional preparation to get into the king's presence and obtain the authority that she needed. The authority that she needed to expose wickedness, to depose the enemy who was Haman, and to impose God's will and order and put it in place by authority that was given to her. That was a powerful statement right there. She went through intentional preparation to get into the king's presence, to obtain the authority that she needed to expose wickedness, depose the enemy, and impose God's will and order and put it in place. I know that 22, and y'all know what I'm referring to, governmental authority is exciting as you think about what it represents, but it costs to carry it. Come on. It's a great cost to carry it. The type of oil in the lamps of the 10 virgins was the most expensive that one could buy. The wise virgins paid the price, and the foolish ones did not count the cost, yet the foolish ones wanted the revelation and the provision of the wise. But it was too late, because great authority comes to the prepared ones. Come on. The parable of the 10 virgins, the tradition behind it says that for this wedding procession, they were to each carry their own torch with their own oil in a tank or on a wick. Proper preparation had to be made for the torch to stay lit. Before I go further, let me pause and say this. I don't know everything that's coming in the months and in the years ahead, but I can say this with confidence, that because of the Word of God and because of the Spirit of God, there will be a remnant who is ready to deal with anything. Are you with me? They will be ready to deal with anything, but the price must be paid to carry something that cannot be denied, because the times demand that the ecclesia carries this authority that cannot be denied for such a time as this. And I will say that the fruit is what is going to prove that you and I walk in 22. Come on. The fruit is going to prove that you and I walk in governmental authority that opens and closes door. There are many in the body of Christ who are coming to the party. They're coming to the wedding party. They're coming to the conferences. They're coming to revival. They're coming to events. But are they the prepared ones? Come on, somebody. Yes? And this preparedness is perpetual. Are you with me? Continually checking our lamps and our postures and our protocols and our readiness as Jesus tarries. The spiritual authority that's needed to steward the end time move of God demands proper preparation, because great authority comes to the prepared ones. Preparation is to put in proper order, condition, or readiness. Authority, is the power to determine, adjudicate, or otherwise settle issues or disputes. A jurisdiction, the right to control, command, or determine. Does any ecclesia know what I'm talking about? Come on. So the Lord showed me three things about preparation that results in the fourth thing. Are you ready? Shout yes. Four things about preparation for 22, and y'all know what I'm referring to. Number one, purity matters. Purity matters. Esther went through 12 months of purification and preparation. 12 is the number of what? governmental authority. She went through an intense, deep cleansing and a deep intentional readiness. Emotional probably too, readiness. For Esther, we know this was external. It's internal for us. Come on. When it comes to spiritual authority, this is a good note to take. Without purity, we will operate in arrogance. Ah. Yeah, you need to clap on that one. Amen. I don't think there's probably anything more that I love to bust up than an arrogant spirit. Come on, somebody. I don't mean this in an arrogant way. Hallelujah. But there's very little that will intimidate me. Come on. And I don't mean that in the wrong way. It's just that, you know, we got to stop that kind of stuff. Come on. Are you with me? We got to stop that. And without purity, we operate in arrogance. Purity matters. I'm talking tonight about the prepared ones get great authority. And some who think they're prepared walk in great arrogance. Help me, somebody. Arrogance is an offensive display of superiority or self-importance or overbearing pride. I'm going to preach right now. A telling sign of impurity, my friends, or perversion, and I will emphasize perversion, is overbearing pride. Overbearing pride. Arrogance, defensive display of superiority. Unprepared warriors exalt self, and prepared warriors exalt him. The Lord is shouting this from the heavens louder than he ever has before. For 2022, if we're going to carry that authority, he must increase and we must decrease. Come on. He must increase and we must decrease. Spiritual authority, my friends, doesn't have to be announced. It announces itself. When you walk in, it is evident that you carry something. You don't have to announce it. You don't have to tout it. You don't have to shout it. You just operate in it. Come on, somebody. John the Baptist didn't go out to see them. They came out to see him. Come on. The point is this. When you carry this authority, or number 22 in 2022, people will come in search of it, because capacity carries authority. Help me in the room. John didn't create a podcast. John didn't create a mailing list. John didn't create a social media that had fake followers. Help me, somebody. You say, does that really happen? It really happens. And then you have to write public figure, and I don't even know what that really means, on your account. I'm serious. Can I just say it like it is? John didn't do any of that, but what did he do? He prepared for authority. He prepared for carrying authority in a wilderness. Come on. Most of us want the platform. Most in the body of Christ today want the platform. But John went to a wilderness, and people came out to watch him burn. He was on fire and radical for Jesus, and people came out to watch him burn. And the same is true of Paul and Jesus and Moses and David, and need I go on? These were all chosen for authority because they were all prepared. How are you getting what I'm saying? Amen. David, we'll call him the original 22. Come on. This is a quote, not my quote. It says, David completely trusted in God to establish him in the position that he had ordained for him. Hallelujah. Continuing to quote, if we're going to walk in true spiritual authority, this must be our posture rather than mere human political power. Come on. End quote. When preparation has had its work on the inside of us, a great grace, a great wisdom, and a great capacity is given to us to carry that authority. And the fruit will follow the preparation. If there's no preparation, there'll be no fruit of authority. Without pure fruit, the flesh will feel like it is compelled to prove itself. Are you tracking with me? Come on. Arrogance. That is arrogance, my friends. And King Saul didn't wait for Samuel. So what happened? He lost his what? Authority. Help me now. Purity matters. Somebody scream it out in this place. Come on. I'm teaching you about authority because this is 2022 and God says, I am cutting and I am tearing and I need you to make the cut. Are y'all with me? Come on. God needs an ecclesia that understands true spiritual authority. We have made it something that it is not in the body of Christ. It is not a famous person, even though it can be. It is something that can be given to, come on somebody, to anybody that prepares to carry the depth of what God wants to give them in authority. Shout yes. Come on. Woo. I told you I don't stop screaming. Keep screaming. Amen. Thank you. Don't worry. I will. Yeah. There's an all-out attack on purity in our nation today. Let me narrow it. There's an all-out attack on inward purity and authenticity in the body of Christ in our nation. Purity is the state of innocence of heart and innocence of mind. And that dictates all other choices in our lives. That's a powerful statement right there. Our culture is so consumed with perversion and impurity on all fronts, sexual, financial, ethical, relational. Innocence is no longer valued or respected. Innocence is ridiculed, and the innocent one is considered ignorant and out of touch. Are you with me? The pressure is especially strong on our children. It's greater than ever before. The Bible tells us that Adam and Eve were pure and innocent, and they felt no shame. Come on. The first humans were living from a pure place. I'm talking about 22, governmental authority. God needs the remnant to walk in pure, true authority because of what is getting ready to come against this nation. Are you tracking with me? Come on. The prepared ones. They were living, Adam and Eve were living from a pure place, not only in the geographical Garden of Eden, but a pure place in their heart. Watch this. Because of the pure place, God was able to extend to them unquestioned and unhindered authority and dominion. Because of the pure place, God was able to extend dominion to them. Now, we know the rest of the story and how they lost that pure place by gaining knowledge that they were not supposed to be introduced to. This is why we must guard our minds. Come on, somebody. This is why we must guard our minds and our eyes and our ears, because the potential of losing the pure place is just one wrong choice away. My God. How many prophets, how many apostles, how many pastors, how many teachers, how many fivefold, and how many believers, just one choice took them from a pure place into a wounded place. Are you with me? I said a pure place into a wounded place. You say, what in the world, Pastor Kim? Hear me now. We should no longer see all of this dysfunction up in the body of Christ. God says, I need an authority, and I need a remnant who are pure, and purity matters. You may not hear this message much anymore, but I'll remind you again, I'm a holiness preacher, and purity matters. It matters. It matters. It matters. It matters. Because one wrong choice, and you have taken the step from the pure place into the wounded place. And when you are wounded, my friend, I don't care what title that you have, you cannot operate in authority because you're in a wounded place. Are you with me? This is why God is having me scream this message everywhere that I go. It's because he needs his remnant healed. He needs his remnant whole. He needs his remnant pure. He needs his remnant all to arise and say, in the name that is above every other name, I will not take a step away from purity, because the prepared ones understand purity matters. Hallelujah. A wounded place. Your capacity is limited in your wounded place. The soul is diminished, and the soul affects the spirit. You hear me? Soul is diminished. But Jesus came and restored. Come on, somebody. a place of innocence. And he gave us a place of grace for that wounded place, so that once again we could find the pure place. Aren't you thankful for what Jesus did? The process that Esther went through was rigorous procedure. It was demanding. It was time consuming. I'm hurrying. It was invasive. It was interruptive to her normal life. Can I say that the American Christian life as we have made it is over now? Come on. There's a new level of demand if we're going to walk in this 22. Amen. So she went through this grueling process of preparation. I said preparation. And on the other side of this preparation, an authority would be granted to shift a nation. You better get that. On the other side, see that as I'm concerned, and I believe why the Lord gave me this message, is I'm concerned maybe some things haven't shifted because we've skipped the preparation. Come on. On the other side of her preparation, there was an authority granted to her, handed to her to shift a nation. I said shift a nation and overturn the decree of the enemy. Come on, somebody. Come on. On the other side of preparation, authority to shift a nation and overturn the decree of the enemy. It's coming to the remnant. Tell your neighbor, it's coming to the remnant. 6 months of myrrh, 6 months of perfume. This purifying process and preparation created a capacity for Esther in spiritual authority, and it will do the same for the remnant. Number two, humility matters. Purity matters and humility matters. Esther called 3 days of fasting. We know that fasting is an intentional humbling of ourself. She said in Esther chapter 4, verse 15 and 16, Mordecai's reply, assemble them, everybody, I'm paraphrasing, tell them to fast for me, we're going to fast also, and then I will go into the king. Here's the phrase, without purity, we will operate in arrogance. Without humility, we will operate in manipulation. I'm talking about spiritual authority. Come on. Without purity, we will operate in arrogance, and without humility, we will operate in manipulation. And I quote, not my quote, someone else's quote, so much of the authority that is exercised in the church today is counterfeit, which causes those who use it to strive and be fearful and intimidated by anyone that they cannot control. Come on. End quote. If not prepared, manipulation will be our choice. There is a fine line, hear me now, between manipulation and motivation. Help me. And the difference is in the heart. True spiritual authority is obtained by a true heart of humility, total trusting in God, and all glory going to God. Did you know that it is possible to do right things with a rebellious attitude? Help me, y'all. Am I preaching or what? I mean, come on. I'm just going to, come on. It's possible to do right things with a rebellious attitude, and we need to have careful consideration in 2022 of the posture of our heart. Motivation, however, in our modern church culture has become soft, and it has become shrouded in the fear of man. Sometimes I understand this clearly from the type of preaching that I do, as some get a bit offended or whatever about it. You may be in the room, and that may happen tonight. I'm not doing it intentionally. It is a mantle. It is a mandate, an assignment on my life. Look, not all things are negative, but not all things are positive. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And in the body of Christ today, motivation has become very wimpy. It has become very soft and shrouded in the fear of man. Therefore, correction has been replaced by coercion, and mentoring has been replaced by manipulating. Come on, somebody. Oh! But true motivation carries an authority that can confront sin and religion with such a grace that compels people to respond to Jesus. It's speaking the truth in love. Manipulation is witchcraft. Help me, y'all. Manipulation is witchcraft. And witchcraft has no authority. All it has is manipulation. All it has is the twisting. Motivation, however, sounds something like this. I don't condemn you. Go your way. Sin no more. Come on. somebody, that's what motivation sounds like. This was the heart of Jesus. He didn't condemn her, but he looked at her, and this is my paraphrase, you better not sin anymore, because if you sin more, you're going to end up right in the same place. Are you with me? Now, I know I added to that, but we know what Jesus was saying. He was motivating her in the sense that he called out the sin, but yet he told her, there's a future for you. Come on, clap on that right now. Hallelujah. I quote, not my quote, hype, soul power, reliance on flesh is all manipulation by counterfeit authority, end quote. Humility matters. Shout it. Humility matters. Esther knew the daunting responsibility that had been given to her. It could cost her her life. She chose preparation by fasting, by willfully humbling herself, and also asking others to fast with and for her. This is not a message on fasting extensively tonight or in depth. We all understand that. Maybe you're in a fast right now. We are at our church as well. But understand this. What Esther knew is, I can't do this by myself. Come on. Humility understands, I can't do this by myself. No more lone rangers in the intercession. Come on now. I said no more lone rangers in the intercessors. Come on. No more lone rangers in the prophets. No more lone rangers in the pulpit. No more lone rangers in the pew. It's time. This is why it's amazing that this is my fourth message in New Jersey. And we got my We Won't Settle buddy, who has been to what? Three of them. Am I right? Three of them. He has traveled around. His buddies couldn't come tonight, but he has come. I was at his church last year in Jersey City, come on somebody, and he has traveled around when his buddies couldn't be here because they're working, to all of these churches in this region of New Jersey. What does that mean? That means that there are people like here, many people like him, that says, you know what, we can't do it all in Jersey City. We got to have some people in Basking Ridge. We got to have some people in what was the other place? Camden, yes, hallelujah, in Camden. And what was the other place? Hallelujah, that place, glory to God. Y'all got some weird names up over here, come on. And I draw him out, number one, because he's got one of our t-shirts on. Come on, somebody. But I draw him out as well because it's a perfect picture. Not only does he love to be in the presence of the Lord and in the house of the Lord, and he's willing to drive around this region to be in it, but I believe that he is representing the heart of many people, and probably many of you and many others across this state, that says, you know what? We are weary. We are tired. We're tired of pressing. We're tired of pushing. This could cost us our life. This could cost us our reputation. This could cost us everything that we have. But together, you say, we don't care. Because we aren't going to settle for religion. We're not going to settle for the status quo. We're not going to settle for just a little clap and a Disneyland performance. Every time we come to church, we're going to link arms together. And in the name of Jesus, we're going to exercise authority on this hill. And we're going to fast. And we're going to come together. And there will be another great awakening, because humility matters. I said humility matters. You hear what I'm about to say? That the day of the big shot in the spotlight is coming to an end. Coming to an end. The spotlight is going to go dim, and the glory is going to go to him. It's got to happen. It's got to happen because you have lifted, when I say you, I don't mean you personally, but you know what I'm saying, the body has lifted up men and women. Come on. We've lifted up men and women. And I know the principle of honor, and I believe in that, and I agree with that. The principle of honor, that needs to be there. It's biblical, it needs to be there. But it has gone way past honor. Come on, somebody. In some cases, it's gone to worship. Are you with me? In some cases, it's gone to idolatry. I'm just going to preach it. Come on. I understand that the fivefold has a place in the body of Christ. We are to equip the saints to do what? The work. We are to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. That's hopefully what I'm doing right now. Help me, somebody. Come on. Come on. This is my sixth message in 5 days. Help me, y'all. Four of them here in New Jersey. But that's not what it's about. You honor, but you don't spotlight. Come on. I told our people here recently in one of the messages that I preached, quit. What did I say? I said something like, quit making idols out of us. Come on. Because not only is it hurting you or us, it's hurting you. Everybody say humility matters. Say humility matters. Say purity matters. Are y'all getting it tonight? I know you are. You're wonderful. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Humility matters. Esther said, I need others to fast with me. We lay down our lives. She said, if I perish, I perish. Right? Is that what she said? If I perish, I perish. Come on, remnant. If we perish, we perish. I mean, seriously. You know, I mean, literally perish, you know, kind of thing. We're just going to go to heaven. Come on, somebody. We're just going to go to heaven. But the awesome thing is that we will have done the will of God. Esther said, if I perish, I perish. We lay down our cross. We take up our cross, we lay down our life, we crucify our flesh. This, my friends, is preparation for 22. True spiritual authority, I quote, is not an honor or a position to be sought. It is a burden to be carried. Hallelujah. Anything less and we will have to manipulate. My God. Anything less and we'll have to manipulate. Are y'all getting that? I'm going to move to the next point, but watch. Anything less than that, you don't. When you carry true spiritual authority, you don't have to manipulate. No reason to manipulate. Why? Because you're just carrying the authority. And fruit is following. Are you with me? Fruit is following. And you're glorifying God because of the fruit, but yet you're willing to let the spotlight go to Him because humility matters. Amen? So the fruit is following simply because you're carrying spiritual authority, not manipulating. Strategies matter. Number three. I'm almost done tonight. Hallelujah. Are you getting it? Say yes. Here we go. You ready? Strategies matter. Without purity, we'll operate in arrogance. Without humility, we'll operate in manipulation. And without strategy, we will operate in vain. Come on. It will be unsuccessful and it will be ineffectual. The Bible says in Esther 5, verse 7, that she replied. Now listen to this. My petition and my request is this. If I have found favor in the sight of the king, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and do as I request, may the king and Haman, all right now, come to the banquet that I prepare for them. Tomorrow I will do as the king says, and I will express my request. Has anybody thought like I thought? Say strategies matter. Talking about spiritual authority. I'm talking about 2022. Are you just walking into 22 or are you walking in 22? Preparation matters when it comes to spiritual authority. God needs a remnant. You say you're repeating yourself. I absolutely am. Come on, somebody. The things that are coming into this nation, the things that will face the ecclesia and the remnant, we need to understand true authority. Have you ever thought like I did? Esther? Girlfriend. Why didn't you just take him out on the first banquet? Seriously? I'm not alone in that, right? Why did you not just take him out in the first banquet? He's like right there. You know, I would be like, it's him. King. Him. First banquet. But when you have the mind of the Lord, when you have the government on your shoulders, carrying the authority, you hear the voice of the Lord, strategies matter. Come on. Strategies matter. Spirit-inspired strategy. I'm almost done. We're going to pray tonight because there's authority on this hill. Come on, somebody. Spirit-inspired strategy matters when operating in spiritual authority. Many times throughout the word of God, he would give one strategy for one battle and another strategy for the next battle. The key was to know the strategy. We knew that there was a battle. Come on, somebody. We knew that there was a battle. They knew that there was a battle, but the key was knowing the strategy. Are you with me, American Christians? We know that there is a battle, but the key is knowing the strategy. Come on. past protocol that has been adopted in the body of Christ is not going to work in this season's warfare. Come on. Our pomp, our platforms, our protocol will not be effective in this season's warfare. Esther's intentional preparation of purity and humility brought her to a place of exposure, and true authority was granted to her. She remained hidden until it was, that was a strategy. She remained hidden until it was God's time and God's timing. I know we want things bad. I know we want things to shift and to overturn, but there is a timing of God. He's waiting on us to get prepared, get out of assumption, get prepared, get in order. Are you with me? And then work in His timing, because in the end, and I'm going to tell you the end, we have the victory. Come on. In the end, He has the victory, but we must hear His strategies. Come on, somebody. Come on, remnant. We must hear His strategy. And so she remained hidden until it was His time, because hidden is the prerequisite. Hiddenness is the prerequisite to true authority. There are too many that are playing all their cards and they're jumping out of the box before it's time. And they have no strategy, so everything is in vain. Listen now. Esther did not reveal her nationality. She did not reveal her people until the right time and the right strategy. She went through the preparation process. She operated in warfare. And this is what she did. I repeat what I said at the beginning. She exposed wickedness. She deposed the enemy from his position. And she imposed God's will and set His authority in place. Come on, somebody. Hiddenness. I'm just going to say this. I'm almost done. I've only got one more point, and it goes really short. And we're going to run to the altar and pray. But let me tell you this. Hiddenness is going to be more important in this season than it ever has before. We have got to go off the grid more. Pastor said it earlier. If social media is a bondage to you, if it is an addiction to you, you need to go off the grid. Come on, somebody. If anything, closing yourself off, getting away. Come on. And I'm talking about all of us. The platform, the pulpit, the pew, whatever it is. We have got to be able to hear clearly the voice and the strategy of the Lord in this season. This is how we will walk in great authority. We've got to disengage from all of the chaos and the chatter and the clutter. It's more important than ever before, because you got to understand, if you get up in here and you're starting to decree and to do all this stuff and you don't have that and you haven't prepared, you're not fooling God and you're not fooling the devil, because both of them recognize legitimate authority. Come on, somebody. And I close with this. Hallelujah. Because she prepared. Purity matters. Humility matters. Strategy matters. Esther and Mordecai were able to walk in full authority. She walked. The Bible says that they wrote. This is Esther 9:29. Esther and Mordecai, the Jew, wrote with full power and authority to confirm the letter about Purim. Are y'all getting this? In 30 seconds, maybe 45 seconds, I'm going to have you stand. Watch this. Purim was a celebration of victory. Come on. So I end with what I began with just a few moments ago. I sense that this can be a year of immense harvest and victory for revival. Great authority will be given to the prepared ones. She wrote with full authority, and even before they wrote Purim, what they did, Esther went in and reversed the decree of the enemy. She said, King, I want you to know that there's this decree that you were manipulated into making by Haman, and it's out there and it's going to kill my people. Do you see her strategy? She reveals. She's not in hiddenness. She reveals. She'd kill my people. King, we need to reverse that. The scepter of authority was granted to her. The decree was reversed. What happened? My God, listen. listen to this. That what happened was she broke the residue of captivity off of her people. If we need that more than ever before in the United States of America, and not just our nation, the heathens, we need it in the people in the church. We got to break the residue of captivity off of the people of the church in this nation. And she went up and she says, it's not enough for Haman to be hanged. We got to overturn what he put in place. And with her authority that had been granted to her because she prepared, she went in and reversed that. And as a result, we sang about it tonight, Pastor Peter. We freed the people. She freed the people because only free people can set other people free. Come on. And then she wrote, and Mordecai wrote with full authority, we are going to celebrate the victory. We are going to celebrate the victory. I decree, I declare, the church in this nation, we will celebrate. The remnant in this nation, we will celebrate the victory. It will come with the full authority to the prepared ones, understanding that purity and humility and strategies matter. Are you with me? And they are willing to be cut. They are willing to be torn. They are willing to do whatever it takes to make the cut, to be on the side of the remnant. And God says there is coming a time in the United States of America. I have not forgotten about this nation. Do not be discouraged. Keep pressing. Keep pushing, because the remnant is being identified, and soon they will write with full authority, we celebrate the victory of our King. Somebody shout. Come on. Come on. Jump up on your feet all over this building right now. Come on, put your hands together and shout victory. Victory. Lift your hands and pray in the spirit. Any keyboard player or whoever wants to come, come now. Come on, lift your hands and pray in the spirit. I'm just going to lead for a few moments longer, and I'll turn it over to the pastors. Come on, I feel that there is an assignment on tonight. I heard the Lord speak. There is authority on this hill. There is authority on this hill. It comes to the prepared ones. Come on, lift your hands. You're lifting your hands is a posture of surrender. It's a posture of receptivity. Come on, pray, pray, louder, louder, louder. Oh, rise up, remnant, rise up, remnant. 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 Oh, yeah. Oh, rise up, prepared ones. Rise up, prepared ones. Oh, Lord, we will not walk in assumption. We will not walk in presumption, oh God. We will do the hard work of preparation, oh God. Oh, Lord God. Oh, Lord, we want clean hands and a pure heart. We walk in humility before you, God. Lord, we humble ourselves in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask for strategies in this day that we live, oh Lord. I ask that you drop strategies in the hearts of the intercessors in this region. Lord, the churches even that I have stood in, Lord, this weekend in this region. God, I pray that you drop strategies, strategies, strategies in the name of Jesus. Lift your hands. Come on, lift your hands and receive strategies, strategies. Keep praying, keep praying, keep praying. I don't know what your protocol for altar is, but if you feel comfortable coming down, I want you to come to the front. Come on, keep praying, keep praying, keep praying. Don't stop praying. Come on, you can pray and walk. You can pray and walk. Come on, hurry, quickly, 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 quickly. Come on, revivalists, respond quickly, y'all. Revivalists, respond quickly. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, it's going to be intense right now. We're going to have a time of repentance. We're going to have a time allowing the Lord to search us. And then we're going to have a time of declaration. I said, there's authority on this hill. There's authority on this hill. Lift up your hands once again. When we lift our hands, it's a posture of receptivity and a posture of surrender to the Lord. Hallelujah. Lord God, in this place tonight, Lord, I felt you speak. There's authority on this hill. Lord, in this place tonight, we do not walk into this year. We're 17 days into 2022. 22 representing the number of governmental authority through prayer and intercession to open spiritual doors and to shut doors. Lord, we repent of any arrogance in the name of Jesus. Come on, cry out with me. Cry out. Cry out, cry out, cry out. Search our hearts, O God. Show us if there be any wrong way in us, O God. Lead us in the right way, O Lord. We repent, O God, of any arrogance, of any exaltation of ourselves, O Lord. We repent of anything that is out of the order of how you would want us to be, God. Oh, Lord, let all glory be given to God. Let the spotlight go on Jesus Christ, we pray. Lord God, we repent, oh Lord, of any manipulation, Lord. Any kind of witchcraft, Lord, that we may have walked in. Come on, I know this is harsh. I know this is strong, but come on, the remnant has to pray like this. The remnant must pray like this. Forgive us, oh God. Forgive us, oh God, of any manipulation. Forgive us, oh God, of trying to do anything on our own, like King Saul, trying to do something without waiting, Lord, on the prophet of God as was instructed to him. Lord, help us to be sensitive, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we repent. Pray in the Spirit. Come on, let's just pray over that for just a few moments. Come on, let the Lord work. Let the Lord reveal. Let the Lord uncover. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Do it, Lord. Koya da 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 ba shika to do bo bo. Do bo ba ba shika ta da da ba shika ta da da ba. Ha da 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 ba shika to do bo 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 shi. Do bo 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 shi ya da 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 ba ko to do bo sho do. Do bo bo ba ka to do bo she de ke. Do bo bo ba ha sho de ya da 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 ba ko ta. Come on, come on, don't quit, don't quit. Press in, press in. Father, I pray that you would reveal to us on even a greater, a deeper level how much we need each other, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Come on, receive it and pray it right now. Not only just each other in this room, Lord God, as a church family, but how much we need each other in the body of Christ. How much we can sharpen one another. How much, Lord God, we need to lean on one another, especially in the days that are ahead, oh God. Father, I pray, yes, for unity, but I pray for revelation, oh God, of how much we need one another, Lord. As Esther said, fast for me, and I will fast with you. God, I pray that we walk in humility together, knowing, oh God, that it's going to take every single one of us to birth a nation-shaking, history-making revival. Not just a revival in New Jersey, but a revival across this nation. Come on, pray in the Spirit on that. Pray in the Spirit on that. Pray in the Spirit. We need each other. We need each other. We need each other's encouragement. We need each other's correction. We need each other's support. We need each other's prayer. Oh, Lord, let there be, oh God, a massive linking of arms in the Spirit and a linking of hearts across this nation in the remnant, I pray, in the name of Jesus, so that we can walk in full authority and overturn the decrees of the enemy in the name of Jesus. Go ahead, go ahead, go ahead. We need each other, we need each other, we need each other, we need each other. Here's what I'm going to pray, pastors, for you and your people here in this church and any others that may be visiting from this area, this region. Now, you hear me, because one of the common things that we hear, myself, my husband, Revival at Fresh Start, is that our region is so saturated with religion, people say. I'm quite sure you can say that about this. I don't know a lot about this region up here historically. Well, some I do, but not deeply. But I understand this. That spirit is everywhere. Are you with me? And that spirit is a primary spirit, an antagonist, against revival. I'm a revivalist here tonight. And hear me. And you may have heard me say the phrase, just to make religion mad. That is what I set out to do everywhere that I go, is to make that spirit mad. Why? Because that spirit is what is holding back the full release of revival. You may realize it, you may not realize it, but here's what I'm going to pray, that God give you specific strategies. Come on, Esther. Come on, Mordecai. God give you specific strategies in prayer. And I know this is an interceding church and an interceding house of intercession, prophetic, etc., etc., etc. But just put all that aside for a moment and say, God, what we've been doing to this point hasn't worked to the degree that we know that it's supposed to. So we need a strategy right now for such a time as this. Are you with me? God, we need a strategy to come against religion for such a time as this. Hear me now. Within and without, you got to search your heart. Make sure there's no level of religion in you. What is religion, Pastor Kim? Look. I'm discipling you in revival right now. Religion is anything that keeps you from the fullness of God, because revival is the fullness of God. There can't be any religion or religiosity in us, no matter what that looks like. Religion and religiosity is not just old-time Pentecost where they made you wear certain things. Come on, somebody. That's not just religion. That's part, but that's not it. There's what I call new school religion. New school religion, old school religion made it too hard for you to get in. New school religion makes it too easy for you to stay away. So we've got to search our hearts. As we are asking God for strategies to bust through religion and religiosity in our regions, we have got to search our hearts. And we've got to say, God, I humble myself before you. I give you absolutely everything. Show me if there's any, because religion is arrogant. Come on, somebody. Religion is arrogant. Religion is a know-it-all. Y'all know your Bible. You know the Pharisees. It's a know-it-all. And Jesus just looked right at it, and y'all know what Jesus said to it. Hear what I'm saying? We got to search ourselves. I'm taking you through a process that we went through at Fresh Start Church 8 years ago. Are you with me? And now, even into this day, we don't tolerate it. We don't tolerate it in our own life. We don't tolerate it in our atmosphere. We don't tolerate it in our region. Come on. This is what needs to be broken through in order for the direct strategy, come on, of the Lord to be released against this spirit. Lift up your hands. Come on. Pray in the Holy Ghost and cry out, God, I thank you now. First of all, we search our hearts. We search our hearts. No arrogance in us, God. Nothing, oh God, that would lend to religiosity or religious spirit. We cancel it now. And God, I thank you that you give these pastors and you give these intercessors strategies, oh God, to annihilate and to bust through the religious spirit that has settled down upon this region. And I decree and I declare in the name of Jesus, in agreement with you as my brothers and sisters, that strategy will come, and it will come out of a travail. Come on. It will come out of a travail. It will come out of a travail. And you will begin to speak. You may know it in with your understanding, or it may be in your spirit, but it will come out of travail, and it will begin to chip away large chunks at this religious shroud over this region, to open the heavens so the fullness of God can touch down. Somebody shout in this place right now. Come on, right now. Come on, right now, pray in the Holy Ghost. Just 30 seconds over that. My God, I feel that. Strategies. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 That's awesome. That's an awesome sound right there. I said, that's an awesome sound right there. That is an awesome sound. That is an awesome sound. I'm telling you, strategy is going to bust through. You hear me now. This region is not too hard. It's not too hard for our God. This region is not too hard for the power of God. It's not too difficult. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. And we will, you will write with full authority. You will expose the enemy. You will depose the enemy. And you will impose God's will and God's purpose in this region. Revival will break out in full force in Jesus' name. Do you believe it? I know you believe it. For the purpose of agreement, clap your hands and shout unto God with a voice of triumph.